get your Bibles in your hand and look to the word of the Lord.
Glory,
God,
glory, God, glory. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
snake bit, but I'm still standing. Might seem a bit, this scripture might seem a bit normal and familiar to everybody. If you've been in church for any length of time, you've heard somebody preach about this scripture, Acts chapter 28, and Paul being snake bit. And typically the place where they get excited and where the shout happens is at the fact that you have to learn how to shake it off in the fire. But hopefully as I share with you tonight, I will share some things that you might not have thought about before.
Come on.
Perhaps one of the most influential men in the Bible, aside from Jesus Christ, is a man by the name of the Apostle Paul. Now, in my mind, what made Paul such an influential man, just stay with me for just a moment, was number one, that he was the evidence that God can perform a radical transformation. I don't know about anybody in here, but some of us were church people all of our lives, and then even those of us who were church people, we still had some stuff that we were doing, some sneaky stuff behind the scenes. I wish I had somebody to talk that to me. And regardless to whether you were one of the people who were sneaky or you were one of the people who was out there all the way in the world, when God got a hold to you, it required a radical transformation. Who am I talking to another here? One thing that's exciting about Paul's life is that Paul started with one mindset and God completely changed his way of thinking. Yes, Lord.
Jesus, if it does not cause your life to get set on fire, I'm sorry.
Amen. We got a whole lot of this churchy stuff that all come down to the altar. They might even roll on the floor. They might blow bubbles with crosses in them. But I'm telling you, the real encounter with the real Jesus becomes evident when you walk out the door and people are cussing you out. And you say, I'm not going to cuss back at you because I love Jesus. I may not have to know how all the scriptures, but I love Jesus. And because I love him, I know I can't act like I used to act anymore. experience. Because if I ask you, do you have a relationship with God? You say something like this. Well, I pray all day. I pray all day. I'm at my desk and I pray. I'm riding in my car and I pray. But you know what? None of us in here wants a relationship where you're talking to somebody on the fly all the time. Call that to be somebody. Nobody in here wants a relationship. You can't even say you have a real relationship if all we talk is on the fly all the time. We talk in passing. We talk when you're on your way here and I'm on my way there. We can't say we have a real relationship because I don't know anything about you and you don't know anything about me. And that's what the problem is. You don't know what touches God's heart because all you do is give him a laundry list of things you need him to do. Our prayer lives consist of a laundry list of things that we want God to do for us, but we don't want to hear God tell us the places where he wants us to change. Now, you know what? I don't need an amen. I brought my own amen tonight. Yeah, because see, we want a comfortable gospel. Well, I come to tell you relationship with God ain't going to be good. Let me not get ahead of myself. But now we've looked at Paul, his transformation. We looked at Paul being set on fire. We looked at the fact that he didn't just have, at first he had a religious experience, but then he had a real encounter. Now, here's something that I noticed about Paul's life that gives me something to work with here. He's a unique picture as to why men and women don't want to serve the Lord. When you look at Paul's life, he is evidence of why many people don't want to serve the Lord. Number one, because, now let me talk to the men for just a moment since I'm here for a men's conference. Because as men, we like to have control. As long as we can dictate the course of our life and tell them what we're going to do and how we're going to do it, we are absolutely comfortable. Talk back to me, my brothers. Not only that, but we prefer, watch this, we prefer for things to go the pathway of least resistance. What do you mean, Mom? We would rather not have to deal with conflict if we don't have to. We would rather just leave things the way they are and not stress ourselves. You know, that's why we call our wives nags, because they have to address some things that we don't want to deal with. All the ladies should have said amen right there. We don't like dealing with conflict, men. Now, we will challenge stuff when we have to, but we'd rather go the pathway of least resistance. And when things don't go like we want them to, we get uncomfortable. So now, as I look at Paul, his life was marked with more conflict than it was comfort. My brothers, I'm coming to tell you tonight that if you are going to walk with God, expect your life to be marked with more conflict than comfort. See, this generation right here doesn't want to deal with conflict. We think we're supposed to, the old saints will sing a song, they think we're supposed to have on flowery beds of ease. Well, I come to let you know that this woman was never promised to be flowery beds of ease. You're going to have to suffer something. The Bible has declared that it is suffering that gives us patience. It is suffering that gives us experience. And experience is what gives us hope. I wish I had some help right here. Paul's life was marked with more conflict than it was comfort. How do I know? Because on his first evangelistic trip, can I just talk for a minute? On his first evangelistic trip, they had to let him out of a window in a basket in order to save his life. Lord, why did they have to let the man out of a window in a basket in order to save his life? Let me tell you why. Because Paul, when he had an encounter with Jesus, it began to change the thought. In other words, they could no longer get him to officers in the kingdom don't trust him, because they remember who he was. Lord, I should have had a talk to that church right there. Because some of us sitting in here right now, there's a whole lot of people who have a tendency to keep bringing up who you were. You've made transformation. God is changing you from the inside out, but they still keep bringing back up your history and your past. They keep still bringing back up. You remember when you were a whore? You remember when you were homosexual? You remember when you were a liar? You remember when you were a drunkard? You remember when you were in adultery? They keep bringing it up, and they don't trust you. Talk better. I feel like talking in here. Not only do they tell you, not only do they not trust you, but they have an unmitigated call to tell other people about your stuff. Not only do they have a distrust for you in their own heart, but they find themselves talking about you in their to other people. Stuff that other folk wouldn't even know about you until they opened up their mouth and started running their mouth talking. So now, here's more conflict. The people that he's supposed to be with now don't like him. They don't trust him. And the people he used to run with don't want to be with him anymore. God. So what do you do when God starts changing your life and the people that you used to be with, you are no longer comfortable being around them anymore? You go in their presence and they say, oh, you think you're holier than thou now because you go over there to that church. You think because you don't drink anymore, you think you're better than us. That's what they say about you. And now they don't like you. So now as a man, can I talk to my brothers? Y'all sisters can just grab this. But as a man, you feel a sense of abandonment because as a man, we tend to like to have camaraderie. Am I right? We like to have a crew that we can hang with. That doesn't have to be a big crew. Just a couple of fellas that we hang with and we can call our boy. So if anything goes down, I know you got my back. The new crew I'm supposed to be running with doesn't trust me. The old crew that I used to run with don't want to be bothered with me anymore. So we deal with abandonment. Okay? Then you have Paul in this conflict deals with poverty. Y'all remember the Bible says, he said, I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. I know how to whatever state I'm in to be content. Paul was talking about the fact that at some points in his life, he lived without some stuff. The problem as men is we don't like having to go without some stuff, especially if you ever had some need. If you ever had a few nickels to rub together, you don't want to get to a place where you run out of money. See, as brothers, sisters, y'all know what I'm talking about too. But you don't want to be it because there's a sense of security that you want to have when you are operating in your life. And when you don't have enough money to meet the bills of your month, you begin to get uncomfortable and you begin to get frustrated. Now you begin to say, God, I heard somebody say, you supply all of my needs according to your riches and glory. So please tell me, why am I having to do without? Are y'all getting what I'm saying tonight? Paul's life was conflict more than it was comfort. You mean, and these were the reasons why people did not give. We don't want to serve the Lord because we don't want to have to deal with conflict. Not only did Paul deal with all these other things, deal with poverty, all that stuff, but one other thing he had to deal with, he was beat up, he was stoned, and then left for dead. You know what that meant? That meant nobody had his back. That meant he had to fight by himself. Anybody in this room, whether it was a physical fight or whether it was an emotional fight, now let me talk about the emotional fight for a moment. Anybody in this room ever been in an emotional fight where you really wanted to tell somebody what you were feeling and how you were feeling, but while you were trying to tell it, position where you got to go through some things and where nobody can be there. Okay, let me break that down. Sometimes God has to put you in a place where the people you would normally call when you need a loan, they don't have the money to give you the loan that you need.
Ship him over to Caesar. So now he's on his way to Rome.
of the wind. The wind got contrary, Lord. The Bible calls them contrary winds. The winds that hinder your progress. Anybody in here dealing with some wind? They may not be major winds, but they're hindering your they're hindering your progress. Now, by verse 9, saints of God, I'm going to walk this text real quick. By verse 9 in chapter 27, the winds went from contrary to dangerous. Now, they went from contrary to dangerous. Now, when I speak of our need, or should I say our desire for control, another thing that bothers us is when we feel like, brothers, when we feel like our thoughts are irrelevant and our voices go unheard. And we'll tell the truth. You do not like to be, women, let me tell you how y'all can get on my last nerve. Y'all better listen. Act like you don't hear us. Ignore our voice when we speak. Although do what you want to do instead of listening to our direction that we try to give you to help you go the right path. Now, we're not saying we always got it right. I'm not saying that. Man, we make mistakes too.
Amen.
But when the voice of the Lord, Jesus, I'm in somebody's house right now. When the voice of the woman in the house, oh, y'all got to help. The voice of the woman in the house is louder than the voice of the man of the house. We something out of order.
Come on.
When Shabbat Yosef, when your kids honor you more than they honor daddy, there's something wrong in the house. Used to be a day when your kids would act up, they would say, I'm going to tell your daddy, and when your daddy gets home, he's going to hell. And the kids would run scared because they were nervous about what daddy was going to do. Now you say daddy's going to come home, the kids are like, man. Now they're more scared of mama than they are daddy. It's time for the voice of the man to stand back up in the household and the woman to come back into the place where God called them. I'm not saying you're a second class citizen. I'm not saying that a man has a right to treat you like that. But what I am saying is the house has to come back in order. So, why am I bringing up the fact that our voices, that it bothers us for our voices to be irrelevant and unheard, our thoughts to be irrelevant and our voices to be unheard? It's simple because Paul told them, he said, don't set sail. We should not go on this boat ride. But in spite of him saying don't go on the boat ride, his thoughts were irrelevant and his voice was considered nothing. So they went on the ride anyway, and now they were on a course of contrary and now dangerous wind. I'm trying to hurry something to God. Just stay with me a few moments more. And so, now here's what I need you to get. Here's another thing that we have to deal with, brothers and sisters. We have to deal with two words called what if. Are y'all hearing me?
Come on.
What you talking about, Mom? Because Paul was the one who made the appeal to go to Caesar. So he was on the ship because he made the appeal. Somewhere in there, you have to stop. Now, the Bible doesn't say he thought this, but it's not outside the realm of reason that at some moment, psychologically, he had to think within himself, what if I didn't ask to go on this trip? What if I didn't ask him to turn me over to Caesar? I wouldn't be in this storm right now. Some of y'all say right now, you say, what if I never met that joker? What if I never met sweet Sally? What if I had never taken this job and I went with that one instead? Lord. We deal with those real issues of the what if. And that's another thing that bothers us and makes us not want to worship God. Because now we struggle with the fact that we have now lost control because of our own decision. Our decision has pushed us into a place where we no longer have the ability to control things. verse 10, he realizes that there's hurt and journey, hurt and damage that's going to come on the journey. But he's in the will of God. And one of the hardest things to reconcile, apostle, is when you know that there will be hurt and there will be damage, but you're in the will.
Oh.
Amen. Amen.
Listen, here's a prayer you gotta learn how to pray. You might want to write this down. God, give me the wisdom to know what to throw overboard.
Amen.
In this hour of my life, give me the wisdom to know what I need to throw overboard. And let, can I just give you one more thing, one more nugget real quick? Listen, when you start throwing folk overboard, they are not going to like you, and they're going to have some things to say because you're getting them off your ship.
Watch out. Come on. Jesus. Glory.
I know I might not be preaching to everybody, but this is for somebody right here. When you start getting some overboard off your ship, there are going to be people that are going to talk about you. They're going to lie on you. They're going to call you everything but a child of God. They're going to love my whole God. And they're going to put your secrets out in the street. Before they knew you, they kept your secret. They kept you covered. But now they're going to tell all your business because now you're throwing them overboard. You no longer need them. As long as you needed them, they were okay. But when they realize that you don't need them anymore, they're mad and they got to put you out there.
So now the Bible says,
and you just let it be what it's going to be. That's how you know you've reached the place of hopelessness, because you're no longer declaring what God said. You're declaring it just is what it is. Well, I come to let you know tonight that you can't afford to declare out of your mouth not another day. It just is what it is. Because if you keep saying it, you give power for it to keep being what it is. Because the Bible says we are snared by the words of our mouth. You've got to get to a place in Christ where no matter what it looks like, no matter what it seems like, I will not confess what it looks like. I will not confess what it seems like. I will confess what the word of God says. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me.
The ship, after a while, I'm cutting the horses across the field. The ship ran aground.
Yeah.
Now listen, y'all. There's so much meat in this text, I don't have time to deal with all of it. But the ship ran aground. In other words, the front of the ship got stuck. While the back of the ship was getting beat up. Anybody ever felt stuck? There's somebody, I told you I didn't come to preach to everybody, I came to preach to a couple of people. There's some people in this room right now, you feel like you are stuck. And everything behind you, and watch this, it was the front of the boat was stuck, and it was the things that were behind it that were beating up on it. Have you ever been stuck trying to go forward, and the stuff that's from behind you is the thing that keeps beating up on you?
Watch out. Ooh, glory.
You might have had a prison. Now you're stuck, you can't get a job, because the stuff behind you is now beating up on you from behind. Lord, that was it. But now, celebrate, and one thing you want to celebrate is the fact that after you get stuck, God still has a plan in your stuff. God still has a plan in your stuff. You might be stuck, but God is still at work. Because where God is putting you, and watch this, the Bible said that when you were stuck and when the waves were beating against the back of the boat, it started tearing the boat up. But when it tore the boat up, that was the boys that came loose were the things that they needed.
Oh! life. See, I told you earlier in the message that the men, when we deal with it, is what Paul had to deal with. The people who he was supposed to be with didn't want him and he didn't trust him. The people who he used to be with didn't want him anymore. But now God brought him to a sweet place where people who didn't even speak his language are now accepting him. turned out to be deadly. You stopped going to church for a while because they were, okay, So you got the colorful snakes that warn you in advance, but you had to go try it anyway. You had to go be the alligator hunter and the snake hunter and try pick them up anyway. You know you don't have experience trying to discern which is and which isn't. And so your mama done told you don't mess with them. Your daddy done told you don't mess with them. But you still said, oh, I just want to go see. And you going to see got you bit. Mama said, I don't like her. Don't mess with her. But I just want to, excuse me, y'all, her hips. I just want to see. I'm sorry, I'll preach a real gospel. That this is me. Her breasts would. I just want to see.
Your hand is in a bed.